Civic Center filling to capacity. The base value of a top ticket for tonight's game, $67 to sign. They're exchanging hands at three times the face value. Hello again, everybody. I'm Al Michaels, along with Ken Dryden. It should be a great night. I'm sure there are a lot of people in this building who do not know the difference between a blue line and a clothesline. It's irrelevant. It doesn't matter, because what we have at hand, the rarest of sporting events, an event that needs no buildup, no superfluous adjectives. In a political or nationalistic sense, I'm sure this game is being viewed with varying perspectives, but manifestly, it is a hockey game. The United States and the Soviet Union on a sheet of ice in Lake Placid, New York.
Я видел, как приходят люди молодые, как их судьбы ломаются. То есть их моментально, значит, ставят под давление, то есть начинают кричать, оскорблять такому плану. Поэтому мне это было все дико.
А как вы хотите добиваться побед в таком виде спорта, как хоккей? Вы думаете, мы такие все хорошие, такие все добрые, все такие, ну, фанаты хоккея? Поэтому Тихонов и вел так нас самый. Просто надо учитывать, что мы все еще русские люди, советские люди.
The so-called miracle on ice was more than just an Olympic upset to many Americans. It was an ideological victory in the Cold War, as meaningful as the Berlin airlift or the Apollo moon landing. We had just fought in a long and fatal Vietnam War trying to stop the expansion of communism, and it really took a toll on the country. President Jimmy Carter called America a nation in crisis. Something really needed to happen so we could gain our pride back. The Cold War had been a cat and mouse game between the Soviet Union and the USA for over 30 years leading up to the Olympics. These two countries spent years and years trying to outsmart each other while bolstering their nuclear arsenals. It was a battle between communism and democracy. A year before the Olympics, the Soviets had raided Afghanistan to the dismay of the US, and President Jimmy Carter had just announced that the United States was going to boycott the 1980 Summer Olympics in Moscow if the Soviets did not withdraw their troops. Sure enough, they did not remove their troops and the US was going to boycott the Summer Olympics. However, a couple of months before the Summer Olympics was set to begin, the Winter Olympics was going to be taking place in Lake Placid, New York, and once again, there would be serious competition between the Soviets and the Americans.
The USSR hockey team, known as the Big Red Machine, was considered to be the best team in history. They had won four straight Olympic gold medals. In 1979, they faced an NHL All-Star team that had 20 future Hall of Famers in a three-game series, and won two out of three games. Their schedule consisted of about 1,200 hours of practice a year, skating three times a day, perfecting both their individual skill and their teamwork. They had their set five-man unit so everyone knew what the others were doing. They were together for 11 months of the year and would hardly get to see their friends and family. For the Soviets, losing was not an option.
The U.S. hockey team, on the other hand, was a scrappy group of college guys with no real expectations. Their average age on the team was 22 years old, and the team captain, Mike Ruzione, was recruited from the Toledo Blades of the International League. The head coach, Herb Brooks, privately told his coaching staff he would be happy with the bronze medal after losing to the Soviet team 10-3 in a pre-Olympic expedition game. But despite this, they were still a really solid hockey team. They had speed, defense, scorers, conditioning, goaltending, and coaching.
On February 22nd, the two teams stood in front of the sold-out crowd in Lake Placid. Leading up to this game, the Soviet team had captured the previous four Olympic gold medals going back from 1964. But this year, USA made it through the opening rounds with four victories and one tie. However, the Soviets were seeded number one and went undefeated with five victories in the first round. USA was known as the underdogs, and that was shown in the first couple minutes of the game. Soviet Union's Valery Kovachuk deflected a slap shot beyond the American goalie, Jim Craigs, but rising above and fighting back, Buzz Schneider, the only American who had been in the Olympics, answered the Soviets' goal with a high shot over the Soviets' goalie, Frosh Trekha. The first period set the tone for the game, showing the aggression of both teams and the answering back to each other's goal. After another period of wild play and with 10 minutes left, Johnson took advantage of the Soviets' penalties and tied the game to 3-3. To top it off, with 2 minutes left, Mike Arezzo slapped the puck right past the Soviets' goalie. For the first time in the entire game, USA was leading and rose above the Soviets to bring home the win. The game showed the great strength of Americans and how they never gave up.
One game. we played them 10 times, they might win 9. But not this game. Not tonight. Tonight, we skate with them. Tonight, we stay with them. And we shut them down because we can.
Do you believe in miracles? Yes! Unbelievable.
My daughter was in the stadium that night. I said, what was it like? She said, the last time I saw that many American flags, they were burning them. A lot of people looked at it as we beat the communists, we beat the enemy. I think for a two-week period, and maybe a little longer, people felt good about themselves and felt proud to be an American.
It transcended the sport. It was a national win for the country. Couldn't have been alive and not feel wonderful about it.
They were levitating on ice, and it all came together in a beautiful way as the Soviets learned to their consternation.
2 days later, they beat Finland to win the gold.
Four to the gold medal. This impossible dream